Sunshine Cathedral is a different kind of church, where the past is past and the future has infinite possibilities. This is the day our God has made.
We read in the book of Ruth, "In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live in the country of Moab, he, his wife, and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephratites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab, and they remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, he died, and she was left with her two sons. They took Moabite wives. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. When they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. Then she started to return with her daughters-in-law from the country of Moab, and they went on their way to go back to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, 'Go back, each of you, to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find security, each of you, in the house of your husband.' Then she kissed them, and they wept aloud. They said to her, 'No, we will return with you to your people.' But Naomi said, 'Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Do I still have sons in my womb that may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, for I am too old to have a husband. Even if I thought there was hope for me, even if I should have a husband tonight and bear sons, would you then wait until they were grown? Would you then refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, it has been far more bitter for me than for you.' Then they wept aloud again. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her." In these human words, God's voice is heard. Please rise as you're able for the next reading.
The story continues. "So Naomi said to Ruth, 'See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law.' But Ruth said, 'Do not press me to leave you or to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There will I be buried. Not even death will part me from you. When Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more to her. So the two of them went on until they came to Bethlehem. When they came to Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them. And the women said, "Is this Naomi?" She said to them, "Call me no longer Naomi. Call me Mara, for life has dealt bitterly with me. I went away full, but I have come back empty." So Naomi returned together with Ruth the Moabite, her daughter-in-law, who came back with her from the country of Moab. They came to Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest. In these human words, God's voice is heard.
Thanks be to God.
Covenant-keeping God, you call us into covenantal relationships, and you bless those relationships. And so it is that we thank you. Amen.
How do you measure a year?
Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Let us dwell together in peace, and let us not be instruments of our own or others' oppression. And now, may God's word be spoken, may only God's word be heard. Amen. In the book of Genesis, now I know our readings today are from Ruth, and we're going to get to that, but we have to back up a bit. So in the 19th chapter of Genesis, there's a story about a town called Sodom. Ever heard of it? It was a rough place. It was notoriously wicked. Sodom was known for cruelty and for indifference toward those in need. It was known for being unkind to travelers and newcomers to their town. The prophet Ezekiel wrote, "Now this was Sodom's sin. They were arrogant, overfed, and unconcerned. They did not help the poor and needy." That's what the prophet Ezekiel said the sin of Sodom was. You may have heard that some other sin was the sin of Sodom, but no, the prophet Ezekiel said they were mean, and they didn't care about people, and they were selfish, and they were cruel, and that's no good. That's not how we ought to be. Abraham's nephew Lot lived in Sodom. He was considered the most righteous person in Sodom. In fact, it came down to being decided that he was the only righteous person in Sodom. And if he was the most righteous, then Sodom really was a cesspool. Lot one night came across a couple of strangers who needed lodging, and he graciously offered them his guest room. So that makes him seem like a pretty nice guy, right? But things got ugly pretty quickly. While he was entertaining these guests that he just met moments ago, a nefarious gang shows up at Lot's house and demands that he turn his guest over to them. And sexual assault was their plan, and they said as much. And Lot refuses to give his guest up to this gang. He rushes to the defense of his guest, and he says, "I will not let you hurt my guest." Okay, so far Lot's coming out pretty good here. But wait, he's not finished. He says, "I will not let you hurt my guest, but I've got a couple of daughters. And you can have them, and you can do whatever you want to them." Righteous Lot. I don't think so. Well, they don't want his daughters. They know his family. If they'd wanted to hurt his family before now, they would have done so already. No, they want to hurt strangers. They want to demean strangers. They want to abuse and humiliate and dehumanize strangers. And so, send us out the strangers. We'll settle for nothing but the strangers. And so the guests, the strangers, have some tricks up their sleeves, and they repel the gang, and they get Lot and his family out safely. But the next thing you know, Sodom is somehow blown to smithereens, and Mrs. Lot is killed in the process. Lot and his daughters continue on, and they take refuge in a cave. And apparently they found the only cave in the area that had a well-stocked bar, because Lot gets drunk. And while he's drunk, he commits incest with his daughters, two consecutive nights. Righteous Lot, I'm doubting it. Well, as a result of that horrible coupling, both daughters conceive, and the child that one of the daughters conceived is said to be the ancestor of the Moabites. You heard about Moab in the readings today. In other words, the writer is saying that the Moabites are inbred. It's an ethnic slur, a regional slur, a slur against those people. It was dehumanizing those people. The writer is saying that he or she doesn't think very highly of Moabites. Moabites were a stigmatized community. And this writer is buying into the stigma and perpetuating it. They are evil to the core. They are vile to the core. Their very conception came out of a despicable act. They only exist out of something horrifying. Now, you may have heard that story before. Probably they shut it off before they got to the cave part. And you may have heard that that story condemns same-gender love and attraction. That is incorrect. They are mistaken. And in the day of such accessible biblical scholarship, I don't think anymore they're so mistaken as they are just lying. That this is not a condemnation of love or attraction or even pleasure. I defy you to find romance in the story. There's no tea dance. There's no drag bingo. There's no grinder. None of that's in the story. It's nothing to do with gay folk. There's violence. And there is incest committed by the most righteous person in town. But romance or attraction or caring relationships are never in the story. And that story has been used to dehumanize and abuse other groups of people is in itself a sin. But the story we heard read today by Twyla and then by Reverend Ty, that is a story about a caring relationship. And so that story starts out with people in Moab. Now, if Moab is a stigmatized community, and if the stories running about them is that they're just all inbred, how did our people wind up here in Moab? Well, you see, there was a famine in Judah, and a guy named Elimelech migrated with his wife Naomi and their two sons from Bethlehem to the country of Moab. Now remember, we don't like Moab. We've got mean things to say about Moab. We've got nasty stories about Moab. We make up stories about how their whole nation is the result of inbreeding. What could be good in or about Moab? Well, I'll tell you what's good about Moab. They've got food and we don't. There's a famine where we live, and they're doing okay. So for our survival, we need to go somewhere. So we're going to go to Moab and try to survive. We're going to see if we can stake a claim there, if we can start over there, if we can build something there, if we can eat and survive there. When they have food, Moab doesn't seem so bad. But it's even more than that. Because once we get there, once we get there with our family to start over and to see if there's a place for us, they let us come in. What? Let people seeking shelter and asylum and refuge and help, just let them come in just like that. They did in Moab. We were hungry and scared and desperate, and we sought refuge in Moab. And those Moabites, those inbred Moabites, took us in and let us build a new life among them. Elimelech and Naomi discovered that Moabites were people. People with sacred value. Children of God, and that these Moabites can be very generous and very kind, and so their sons grow up in Moab and marry Moabite women. Ruth, in fact, and we'll hear more about this in weeks to come, but Ruth the Moabite is an ancestor of Jesus. The Moabites, those inbred, despicable, vile Moabites, are part of Jesus' lineage, and there's something to be said about that, and we'll say that. Not today, but we will. We will get to that. Ruth, the Moabite, is an ancestor of Jesus. In time, Elimelech dies, and later the widow Naomi's sons die. And they never had children. So when they die, it's over. This is a patriarchal culture, and in this culture, women have no status apart from men. So if Naomi doesn't have a living father, and if she doesn't have a living husband, and if she doesn't have a living brother, and if she doesn't have living sons, and she doesn't have living grandsons, she doesn't have a way of making a living. And so things are very desperate for Naomi. And to make it worse, now that she's lost almost everything, Moab experiences a famine. But now back home in Judah, things are better. And so she says, you know what, I'll just pack up and return to my home country. And at first, her daughters-in-law want to go with her, but Naomi insists that they go back to their families and start their lives over. She says, go back to your religion, go back to your families, go back to your old lives, go back to what you know and start over. You're still young. If you stick around me, there's nothing for you. So go back. And I love that she even says, go back to your religion. There's no condemnation of how someone else worships. Look, if you're in my house, yeah, I want you to worship with me and be part of my thing. But if you're with your family, worship the way they worship. There's no condemnation here. And I love that. It's so often overlooked in our scriptures. But it's there over and over that those people who are different than us are also loved by God. So go back to your Moabite religion. Well, they go back and forth. And finally, she persuades Orpah, one of her daughters-in-law, to do that, to go back to her family. It's a tearful goodbye. She doesn't want to leave her, but she also knows that she has to go on with her life. And so Orpah leaves. But her other daughter-in-law, Ruth, will not abandon Naomi. And so Ruth says to Naomi, "Do not press me to leave you or to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. And where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. And there I will be buried. Not even death will part me from you." Those words are read at weddings between a man and a woman all the time. But the words are originally said by a woman to a woman. A sacred oath, a loving commitment, a lifelong vow from one woman to another, a vow made by a Moabite, a covenant relationship. Please don't miss how powerful this fact is to women, to childless widows, one a Moabite, and they have a sacred covenant, so sacred that the whole story is part of our scripture. But that's not how it's been presented very often, is it? Well, Ruth and Naomi go back to Naomi's homeland, and people who remembered Naomi from way back in the day were surprised to see her. Is that Naomi? And she says to them, "Don't call me Naomi. Naomi means pleasant. And there is nothing pleasant about my life right now. Don't call me pleasant." She said, "My new name is Mara." Mara means bitter. "Call me Mara." She's lost her husband. She's lost her sons. She's lost her chance of having grandchildren. She's lost one of her daughters-in-law. And now she's left her adopted home. She's lost so much. Of course, she feels right now more bitter than pleasant. And she does something that we all do sometimes. When we're up against it, we romanticize the past. She says, "You know what? I left here full and came back empty." You didn't leave full. You left hungry. That's why you left. There was a famine. You left because you didn't have anything. "I left full. It was so good back in the day. Oh, I had it all." You didn't have squat. That's why you left, this lady. But we do that, don't we? "Oh, my man, he was so good. Then why isn't he still your man?" Because there was a minute you didn't think he was so good, right? "Oh, my dad was just perfect. Oh, what a great dad I had. I remember 6 years that y'all didn't talk. If he was so good, it must have been you that was all wrong then, because there was some kind of split going on." We romanticized the past, right? And so she said, "I left here full, and I came back empty." She forgets she has been through challenging times before, and she got through them. She's strong. She's resilient. She's sad now. She's not thinking clearly right now, but she has had hard times before. And what happened before? When there was a famine and she had to do something, she packed her family up and she went to where there was food. She took risk. She did what she had to do, and she got through it. And she will again. We need to know that when we are facing difficulties, this isn't the first time. We have faced difficulties before. We know how to handle it. We always have. We will get through it. We're strong. And she hasn't lost everything. I left full, but I came back empty. You're not empty. You're not empty-handed. Yeah, you've lost a lot. I don't want to belittle the suffering that this family has had. Of course, she has lost a lot, but she hasn't lost everything because she's still got Ruth. And we will find in the weeks to come that having Ruth is having a lot. Ruth is committed. Ruth took her promise, her vow, seriously. Ruth is going to make sure that they're okay. And so you've lost a lot, but you haven't lost everything. In fact, you couldn't lose Ruth. When you tried to ditch Ruth, Ruth wouldn't leave. Ruth is just that close to being a stalker. She won't let you go. "You'll never get away from me." Name that musical. So you've been through hard times before, and you got through it. And you've lost a lot, but you still have something. That change of perception, that perspective, that change of attitude can be miraculous. If we can remember, I've gone through bad times before, I always survive, and yes, I've lost a lot, but I still have something. If we can hold on to that, we have the seeds of a new opportunity. We have the beginnings of a new day. We have created the beginnings of a miracle in our lives. A shift in perception can be the difference between being a victim and a survivor. Well, the story shows us that God's love will never let us go. Ruth's affirmation of love and devotion is not only her commitment to Naomi, it is God's commitment to us. God, the all in all, the omnipresence, the life that expresses in, through, and as our lives, will not abandon us because God cannot abandon us. Whither thou goest, I will go. And when we hear that, we also hear ourselves saying, and wherever I am, God is. And the story shows us something else. The story shows us that love makes a family. Ruth chooses to be with Naomi. She chooses to live her life with her. She chooses to care for her and provide for her and make a home with her and make a life with her. Ruth formed a covenant relationship. Ruth, the widowed, childless Moabite woman, made a sacred vow and honored it. The hero of the story is a person that would have been stigmatized, that by every single evaluation would have either been considered poor or useless or nameless or voiceless or even bad. And she is Jesus' ancestor. She is the hero of the story. She is the one who initiates the sacred covenantal relationship. If you think that you're not good enough to give love, to receive love, to make a promise, to keep a promise, think again, Moabitess. Think again, Ruth. Think again, childless widow. Think again, dyke. Think again, fag. Think again, immigrant. Think again, refugee. Think again, asylum seeker. Think again, person in their fifth round of chemo. Think again, person on dialysis. Whatever anyone else has said, you are a person of sacred value, and your love is holy, and your promise is God's own covenant in your life. And so Ruth forms a covenant with Naomi, a till death do us part covenant, because Ruth knew what we know. Love makes a family. The story shows us that God is love. And wherever love is genuinely expressed is holy ground. Wherever love is expressed is holy ground. This is holy ground. This is holy ground. You and your family are on holy ground. You and your friends are on holy ground. You and your lover are on holy ground. You and your spouse are on holy ground. You and your confusion and your questions and your doubts are on holy ground. Wherever God is, it's holy ground, and there's not a spot where God is not. And this is the good news. Amen.
I act as if I'm not afraid. Make believe that I don't really care. But there's a wounded place in me. And I'm terrified you'll see it. The truth is, I get really sad some days. Struggle just to get up in the morning. But I've never found the courage just to say, please help me, I'm afraid of falling. But I'm lost. I open up. Lord of all ways, being the one. Feels like the whole world is on my shoulders. I should be out there having fun, living, not just growing older, but I'm longing to show I will always